During World War II, Australia worked on and produced an entirely domestically designed tank called the Sentinel, and also modified British tanks with additions such as flamethrowers and mortar launchers. The Sentinel in particular included a number of unique and advanced features that inspired later Commonwealth designs. The Australian Army's experience with armored vehicles goes back to World War I, in which Australian soldiers fought alongside British heavy tanks and even captured a rare German A7V tank. Not only this, but in 1916, Australia formed the first light car patrol, which boasted 3 armored cars at its inception. This marked the origin of Australia's experience with armored warfare. Despite plenty of issues with maneuverability and mechanical reliability, World War I era landships were reasonably successful and certainly contained potential for future development. During the interwar years, Australia imported some British designs, namely Vickers medium and light tanks. By the late 1930s, these designs were obsolete, with inadequate weaponry and speed. With the prospect of war in Asia and Europe growing, Australian commanders and designers realized that major changes to their tanks were needed if they were to successfully defend their country. A domestically designed tank was created, named the Sentinel. Development of the Sentinel tank began in the latter half of 1940 due to the fall of France and Italy joining the conflict, which enhanced the level of urgency in which new weapons needed to be made in order to turn the tide of the war. To make the project easier, designers decided to take parts and inspiration from preexisting tanks. Namely, the Sentinel used the drivetrain and lower hull of the American M3 Lee medium tank, which had recently been designed in the United States. The Sentinel's cast hull made it different from other tanks of the time. Cast armor was higher quality than the welded and bolted construction that most British tanks used. Throughout 1940, the development of the tank was hampered by changing design requirements. For example, in June of 1940, the Sentinel was intended to weigh 12 tons and have 28 millimeters of frontal armor. In August, the requirement was increased to 15 tons, and just a few weeks later, the final requirement was set to a tank with no less than 65 millimeters of frontal armor and 45 millimeters of side armor without a weight prerequisite. These enhanced specifications were necessary to combat newer models of German tanks encountered in North Africa, such as upgraded Panzer IIIs and IVs. Not only this, but aggressive Japanese posturing in Asia, especially after their invasion of French Indochina, placed even more pressure on Australia to defend itself. In addition, the Australian military ordered that 859 Sentinels be manufactured, but in hindsight, Australian industrial production figures never came close to that number. When further designing the tank, numerous manufacturing obstacles presented themselves. First, a shortage of nickel, which was key in armor manufacturing, resulted in metallurgists needing to develop a new type of armor, which they based on zirconium metal instead. In addition, a shortage of Pratt & Whitney Wasp aircraft engines originally intended for the Sentinel meant that the final design had instead 3 Cadillac V8 engines combined together, generating 330 horsepower. Indeed, engines had previously been prioritized for Australian and British aircraft orders, and not many were left over for usage into the Sentinel tanks. As a final note, underlying economic disadvantages, namely the lingering effects of the Great Depression, and many factory workers being conscripted, reduced Australia's production capabilities and factory workers. As previously mentioned, the Sentinel was based on the lower hull and drivetrain of the American M3, but modifications were made to the gearbox, final drive, and suspension to simplify the production process. One aspect of the Sentinel that greatly reduced its production time was that the hull was one piece of casted armor, and the turret was also cast as a single piece. This was a very unique element that not many other tanks in the war employed, at least at this time. Indeed, the M3, of which the Sentinel's hull was partially based, used mostly a bolted and welded construction. The casted design simply proved to be very effective compared to a bolted construction, for it was possible that bolts could become loose or be pushed out of place when hit by enemy fire. Not only did the Sentinel take inspiration from the M3, but also from the British Crusader tank. The Crusader was a highly mobile and low-profile design, balancing armor and firepower, made to exploit breakthroughs in the enemy line. The Sentinel's speed was indeed similar to that of the Crusader, coming in at 48 kilometers per hour. Additionally, it used a 40mm main gun with precise optics and two 7.7mm Vickers machine guns, one in the turret and one in the hull. It had five crew members, but the interior was rather cramped. It also had 65mm of sloped frontal armor and 65mm of turret armor, and 45mm of side and rear armor, which was comparable to other tanks of the time. In July of 1942, the Sentinel was ready for production, and the New South Wales Railway Company in Sydney undertook the task of production. The first 12 tanks produced had serious defects in the armor quality, with the cast hull being very brittle and prone to cracking more easily than it should. However, this issue was soon fixed, and the strength of the armor remained good. Production lasted until mid-1943, and by that time, 65 production models had been manufactured. At this point, Australia ended the Sentinel tank program due to bureaucratic delays, issues with the tank's performance, and the availability of new American M4 Sherman medium tanks. Although issues with the engine and turret traverse system were certainly remediable, the Army and government worried that the time to fix them would be too long. The government preferred to adopt the M4 Sherman because it had already successfully proven itself in battle, and shipping lanes were no longer threatened by the Japanese Navy. In addition, by mid-1943, the 40mm main cannon was far too insufficient to take on new German tanks, such as the Panzer IV G. For these reasons, the AC-1 Sentinel never saw combat, although it was used in the Australian war film, The Rats of Tobruk. However, the story of the Australian cruiser tank does not end there. In mid-1941, due to delays in the Sentinel's development, the AC-2 cruiser was designed, although the project was soon cancelled. It was a modified Sentinel with thinner armor and a less powerful engine, that was designed to be more simple and quick to produce. However, the armor and speed were deemed lackluster compared to pre-existing contemporary tanks, and the government did not want to take resources away from the ongoing AC-1 Sentinel project at the time. Next, the AC-3 Thunderbolt was based on the Sentinel that included many new changes. Development began in December of 1941. The most obvious drawback of the Sentinel was its poor firepower. By 1942, the 40mm cannon was obsolete. Instead, the AC-3 Thunderbolt wielded an 87mm 25-pound howitzer with a modified recoil system and increased barrel length for greater muzzle velocity. The 25-pounder had impressive armor-piercing capabilities and could be used as a close support gun for infantry. Although the weapon was impressive, it was actually considered a stopgap solution until the 76mm 17-pounder cannon could be made available in greater numbers. Given the larger size of the shells, more room had to be set aside for ammo stowage. The interior of the Sentinel and the Thunderbolt was already quite cramped. To make room for ammo, the whole machine gun of the Thunderbolt was removed, and the crew was reduced to four. The Thunderbolt was powered by three combined V8 Cadillac engines in a more optimized arrangement compared to the Sentinel, and could generate up to 400 horsepower. The Thunderbolt's prototype was ready for testing in January of 1943, and it performed exceptionally well. Despite the success, the tank program was ended in July of 1943 due to budgetary issues and the availability of the M4 Sherman. The last of the Australian cruiser tanks, the AC-4, used a modified Sentinel hull with a 17-pounder gun when it became available in late 1942. It was one of the first Allied tanks to fit the 17-pounder, and it later inspired the development of the British Sherman Firefly, which was an M4 Sherman tank with a 17-pounder. The Matilda II was a British infantry tank that had performed well in the North African campaign during 1940. It was heavily armored with 78mm of frontal armor and moved at a max speed of 15 miles per hour. However, by 1941, development of German tanks meant that the Matilda II was becoming outdated. Although obsolete against the Germans, the Matilda II still had potential in the Pacific theater against smaller Japanese tanks, so Australia imported roughly 400 of these Matilda tanks between 1942 and 1945. Indeed, in 1942 there were genuine fears in Australia about a potential Japanese invasion of the country. In 1943, the Australian Army saw an upgraded version of the Matilda II that incorporated a flamethrower. Flamethrowers had potential for successful use in the Pacific theater. They could burn down foliage or sweep out Japanese soldiers from their foxholes, pillboxes, and island tunnel systems. Design work began in 1943, and a prototype was prepared by the following year. Testing of the prototype began in the latter half of 1944. After the final design was settled on, 25 Matilda IIs were converted into the flamethrowing Frog variant. The flamethrower was placed on the turret and replaced the 40mm cannon. A hydropneumatic piston was powered by electricity to build up pressure for the flamethrower. Pressure and fuel were built up in a chamber, and then the piston was released to fire the weapon. When fully charged, the flamethrower could dispense 10 gallons of fuel at a range of 82 meters, which is more than enough for short-range jungle engagements. Specifically, it fired gelatrol, a thickened fuel that could stick to targets. One issue, though, was that it took roughly 30 seconds to recharge the flamethrower. Because of the large size of the weapon, the turret became cramped and the crew was reduced from 4 on the original Matilda to just 3. Not only this, but fuel containers for the weapon occupied additional space within the tank. An 80-gallon tank was placed in the Frog's turret, and other containers were placed in the hull that provided an additional 162 gallons of fuel. There were 242 total gallons. This was in contrast to the British Churchill Crocodile, which was a flamethrowing tank that towed an external fuel tank. In the context of jungle warfare, though, a trailer was deemed too awkward and cumbersome, so internal fuel tanks were issued instead. The 25 Matilda Frogs saw service mainly in the Borneo campaign in the summer of 1945 and proved to be quite successful. Like the Matilda Frog, the Matilda Hedgehog was designed for combat in the Pacific. Australia wanted a tank that could easily neutralize Japanese bunkers. These bunkers were typically buried underneath the jungle terrain and were virtually unaffected by the 40mm Australian cannons on ordinary Matilda tanks. As a result, a modified Matilda was designed that was fitted with a Hedgehog spigot mortar system, which had previously been used on destroyers as an anti-submarine weapon. The weapon was modified so that it fit on a tank. After some testing, it was decided that 7 mortar chambers was the optimal amount of firepower. The mortars were fired via an electric switch from the tank's turret, and they could be fired individually or in a salvo with a 0.3 second delay in between each of the 7 shots. However, if the mortars were to be fired all at once, the turret needed to be rotated in such a way to the 2 o'clock position so that the radio antenna did not obstruct the path of the projectiles. The electrical switch could also be used to change the elevation of the mortars, up to a maximum of 70 degrees. In addition, an armor plate was added to the rear of the tank to prevent damage to the weapons. During testing in 1945, the mortars proved unable to do much damage to bunkers because the warheads detonated before penetrating enough ground above the bunkers. One other drawback was that the mortars could not rotate independently of the tank. However, this did not really become an issue, since the weapons had a massive blast radius anyway, and accuracy wasn't a problem. Indeed, The weapons excelled in clearing foliage, which would be useful in uncovering hidden Japanese positions in the jungle. All seven bombs could clear an area of 3,000 square meters, or 32,000 square feet, with a range of no more than 200 meters. With such a substantial effect, designers hoped that there would be a significant psychological impact on enemy troops to reduce their morale. Also, experiments were done to try to improve the range of the bombs by using a different propellant, but trials were unsuccessful, and the necessary changes were considered too costly. Commanders had to conduct extensive reconnaissance when using the Matilda Hedgehog in the field. First, a limited ammo supply of 7 bombs meant that nothing could be wasted. In addition, overhead obstacles, such as trees, were to be avoided so that the path of the bombs was not obstructed. Tank commanders were instructed to keep in contact with infantry formations in order to quickly strike a target when needed. After testing concluded in early 1945, the Army deemed the Matilda Hedgehog suitable for combat. 6 Matilda Hedgehogs had been converted by June of 1945, but they never actually left Australia to see combat because Japan had surrendered by August. Moreover, even if Japan had continued fighting late into 1945, and if an amphibious invasion of Japan was necessary, Australia planned to replace the Hedgehogs with Churchill tanks instead, since they offered better armor and firepower. Eighteen of these variants were converted, which added a Dozer to the front of the Matilda II tank. They were constructed in 1945 with the goal of clearing Japanese roadblocks, filling shell craters, and clearing paths through the rough jungle terrain. When used in combat, the variant wasn't too successful, for they were difficult to steer and the nose often dug into the ground, immobilizing the tank. Of the 18 Matildas with Dozers, most were converted back into ordinary Matildas by the end of the war. The Sentinel tank struggled with numerous delays that ultimately caused it to become an unsatisfactory combat vehicle by mid-war standards. However, the engineering behind the project was certainly impressive and unprecedented, specifically the fully cast hull and turret. In the Pacific Theater, the modified Matilda II Australian tanks were fitted with weapons intended to make jungle combat easier, but the Japanese surrender prevented large-scale use of these vehicles.